Good evening, everybody. It's my pleasure, on behalf of the State of Palestine Environment Quality Authority, to welcome all of you in our side events. This side event, I would like to thank your presence and participation, this side event, which will be under the Climate Change Planning and Conflict Setting, State of Palestine, which organized by coordination between more than one stakeholder, Mr. Nidal Katba from the Environment Quality Authority. Mr. Nidal is the Minister Advisor for Climate Change, and now I will give him the floor. Welcome, Mr. Nidal.
Good evening. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm sorry that I'm replacing Her Excellency Ms. Adal Atir, the Chairman of Environment Quality Authority. She was not able to be among us here. My talk will be about the climate change planning and challenges under the situation of occupation. State of Palestine lies at the eastern part of the Mediterranean, as we see in the map, in the corner, and surrounded by Arab countries and Israel. So the national territory, as recognized by the UN resolutions, that it is the West Bank, including East Jerusalem and Gaza Strip. So it is the boundary is the green line on the fourth, or the armistice line on the 4th of July, 1967. What is the current situation of Palestine, or state of Palestine, in the UNFCCC process? Palestine is an observer state to UNFCCC. What does this mean? That as an observer, we don't have the right to access all the support that came from the multilateral fund. We lack the direct access to international support, including financial, technical, technological, and capacity building. Recognizing that Palestine greenhouse gas emissions never been among the causes of the global warming climate, while it is severely impacted by its consequences. Yes. So if we are looking for the how the occupation is impacting our daily life, how it's impacting our environment, so I'm focusing in this talk about the impact on climate change planning. Or no, we will all know well that the occupation is impacting every aspect of our daily life. But in this talk, I'm focusing only on the impact on the climate change planning process. So the main challenges that raised from the following aspects. The first of all is land fragmentation and lack of control over natural resources. Natural resources including land, water, everything in our land, we have lack of, we don't have complete sovereignty, we have lack of control over these resources, including land, which is the most important thing. Annexation and expansion, all which make some kind of fragmentation for the land, it makes some kind of annexation for part of the land, it have a huge impact on the ecosystems. The illegal settlements or colonies and bypass roads, which make a lot of the fragmentation for the Palestinian land. Trees uprooting and land shaving, the war in Gaza. And we'll try to be very briefly looking at each of them. Starting by land fragmentation and coming back to Oslo Agreement, we have some kind of classification for the land, including area A, B, and C, in which area A is full control, civil and security administration is for the Palestinian government. This is in theory, I'm saying this is in theory, because currently there is a lot of a breach for this system. Area B is the civil administration is under the control of the Palestinian side, while the security issues is under the Israeli side. We have Area C in which there is full control by Israelis for civil and security issues, while we have the dark pink is annexed land annexed by Israel. So this kind of this is the current situation on the ground. So how you can plan for the land which you can have no any kind of control? When we are talking about sea area, it's more than 62% of our land. So with this situation, how you can make plans? How you can implement these plans? There is a big challenge. So the annexation and expansion. Well, we can see how it is. As we see in the middle photo, we have the Palestinian houses and their olive groves. They are separating the Palestinian houses and Palestinians from their agricultural land. This is the situation. In some cases here, we can see that how the wall is cutting the even the houses. We know that Palestinians have the extended families, so sometimes you and your sister or brother, you have to go around maybe kilometers in order to instead of having in touch within 2 minutes. So the same, we can see the scale. Sorry, go ahead. Illegal settlements and colonies. And you can see in the middle here how this forest, this nature reserve, is transferred from nature reserve, which was in this in March 1997, into what we see in January 2003, and the latest here, the just the last maybe 1 year ago. So how the ecosystems, the nature reserves, is converted from nature reserve into a settled area with settlement on the destroying everything in the ecosystem. Trees uprooting and land shaving, and we a lot of photos like this you can find. Hundreds or thousands of these photos, how they are shaving or making some kind of uprooting for the trees, and sometimes they are these trees they are replanted in the settlements in order to prove that this land was for somebody else. Please. War in Gaza. We all heard about what's happening in Gaza. Three wars in less than 8 years. Every war, it was, you can't believe how it is impacting on the daily life. You can see in the middle here how the white phosphorus, this is a UN school. It was a shelter for the refugees. How it was hit by the white phosphorus, which is illegally weapon. We can see the different photos how this is how it was impacting the lives of Gaza people. What about the climate change? Regarding the observation of the incubation impact on national climate change related projects. So please. Okay, so we are taking here only two samples in order to see how is the equation really impacting the daily life, the climate change planning. We have two examples here. We have two projects implemented, thankfully, by support from UNDP and the kind from the donors. Well, the first was the first effort was started in 2008 about development of national climate change adaptation strategy, which is we know well that the world is working on climate change either in mitigation or adaptation. Our main focus and our high priority is adaptation. So we are able to have some kind of support from the UNDP. It was London School of Economics who were supporting us in this issue, in which more than 72 Palestinian stakeholders was effectively involved in planning a climate change adaptation plan or strategy for Palestine. That was in 2010. It was supported UNDP, in which a lot of interventions were recognized about how to be able to cope or to adapt to climate change. What are the main threats that was discovered in this adaptation strategy? First of all, it was a decrease in optimal farming conditions, decreased crop and livestock productivity, increased risk of floods, increased risk of drought and water scarcity, increased irrigation requirements, increased risk to public health. And so, in summary, climate change had and will have negative impact, severe negative impact on water security, food security, health, infrastructure, and socioeconomic in general. So in this adaptation strategy, we recognized or we defined. Okay, maybe I need 2 minutes more. Okay, so we recognize some kind of no regret adaptation options. No regret means that it has low cost. It is a win-win approach. Even if the climate is not changing, we are winning. So such options, most of them are not going through them, but most, if not all of them, needs some kind of sovereignty or control over resources, which we don't have, unfortunately. Why? Because the Israelis control everything in Palestine. The second project is mainstreaming environment and climate change, and thanks a lot for the Belgium government for the kind support. It was 1.45 million euros, and it is the most important and national at the national level climate change planning. So in which we have four components: the national communication, which is doing this exercise on a voluntary basis; the national capacity development program; some kind of pilot projects; and supporting some NGOs. In the first national communication report, we have, fortunately, we were lucky to have Ricardo on board. They are doing a great job. They are UK, London-based. They are renowned in the international community for their high-quality work. We have three packages in this communication report. We have the national greenhouse gas inventory and mitigation, vulnerability assessment and NAB, national circumstances and other information. For the inventory and mitigation, because of the current situation of incubation, we were compelled to have two baseline scenarios. The first scenario is that the incubation is ended yesterday. So we are expecting that there is no incubation. We have full sovereignty over our land. We have free lands. We have free hands to have our plans and to be able to implement these plans. So we have the baseline scenario without incubation, and the other scenario if the incubation persists. So we are expecting that it will be end now and not tomorrow, and the other way to have the status quo when the equation is still there. And the same applies for the mitigation. Depending on the greenhouse gas scenarios, we have the mitigations either with and without the equation. The same for the adaptation planning. We have our plans, but whenever you have full control and free hands over your resources and your land, you'll be able to make your plans, and you're able to be free hands to implement these plans. With this current situation of occupation, what you can do on the ground is limited. In conclusion, to be efficiently responding to climate change in both adaptation and mitigation, occupation should be ended now. It is a human right. It's a non-questioned right to have full sovereignty over natural resources and national and natural resources to cope and adapt to climate change. So this is the holiness, our Bob prayer for end of incubation now. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Now I will give the floor to Mr. My friend, Mr. Shar, John Shar. Development Cooperation, Consulate General of Sweden in Jerusalem. Really, Mr. John Shar is the head of the Development Cooperation at the Consulate General of Sweden in Jerusalem. He has worked with World Resources Institute and was the director of International Commission on Climate Change and Development launched by the government of Sweden. He has held positions on humanitarian affairs, environmental and climate change at SIDA, Stockholm, and worked for the Red Cross, Red Crescent Movement, mainly in Asia, and he holds a PhD in agricultural science. I welcome you again. Welcome.
I'm very glad that we can hold this side event today. For all of us here, it's important to recognize that Palestine, as a member and a part of the international community, is being exposed to exactly the same impacts of climate change as all other nations, and have the right to deal with its consequences, but also to contribute to solutions to the impacts of climate change. I'd like to make three points, partly addressing the same issues as my colleague Nedal has done, but from a slightly different perspective. I'd like to talk about first, what can Palestine expect? What does Palestine need? And thirdly, what does Palestine have? And then I'll try to draw some conclusions on this basis. So what can Palestine expect in terms of climate change? Well, we know that some of the most accurate climate models are actually for this region. I think models agree, and impacts are quite clear in terms of a warming climate, a drier climate in this part of the Middle East region. So there's a high degree of certainty about the impacts, the expected impacts in Palestine. And of course this, as in all other regions, it's likely to be followed by great variability in terms of weather and climate. This year, We've had an extremely warm September in Palestine. We've had unexpected droughts in the north. We've had floods in the south, and this is a kind of indication of what it is that we can expect in the future. Obviously, Palestine's carbon footprint is light as a feather. Nevertheless, as we have seen, Palestine has made its GHG inventory. It's reporting its national communication to the UNFCCC. So it's part of the process and doing its part in terms of the procedural steps that are now taken by all nations. This is a region which has great potential, of course, in terms of renewables. The potential of solar energy is obvious to everybody. So there are also gains to be made in Palestine. When all these consequences and effects come together, we know that we will expect very complex phenomena that are difficult to predict in their details. We will see natural, physical, social systems interact in ways that are very difficult to foresee. We can expect non-linear developments with thresholds and tipping points, and exactly what they will lead to we cannot know. We are seeing impacts today, but we know that this is for the long term. We may understand what will happen within the next few years, but in the long term it's very difficult to understand exactly how this is going to play out. And we know that there will be local consequences, direct local consequences, but Palestine is part of the international community and will also be subjected to all those kinds of effects that are global. One example of this is what I think now most agree happened in Syria the years leading up to 2011, when we had a very serious drought, climate change induced, which forced many people to move from the rural areas to the cities, while we at the same time had the food price spikes in 2008 and 2009 that made the situation even worse, and this sort of contributed to the unrest that led to the events that unfolded in 2011. So this is an example of how very complex phenomena will interact and cause something which cannot be predicted. So this is what Palestine can expect. What does Palestine need in terms of dealing with this? And I'd like to approach this from a sort of ideal and governance perspective, and particularly looking at the adaptation part. Obviously, adaptation, I think, will have a higher priority in Palestine than mitigation for the next few years. So what is needed in terms of dealing with these kinds of effects? Ideally, a society that has to cope with this kind of complexity must have the ability to invest, to learn how investments play out, to change and adapt as things evolve and as society and governments learn about the effects of these measures. In order to do that, it has to engage its population through participatory processes. It has to have open deliberations with the population in order to gauge the impacts of what's happening and have strong involvement and participation. It needs to be accountable to its population. It has to have the trust of its population in order for people to accept measures that the government may take to deal with climate change. It needs to be able to plan not according to administrative borders, but according to natural borders. We all understand that planning has to be along watersheds. It has to look at landscapes rather than administrative units. So this kind of holistic approach, which will also require that you can deal with your neighbors. If you share, if you have transboundary water, you need to be able to work with your neighbors on the necessary measures. You need to decentralize, you need to give a lot of power and empower local communities so that they can take measures that they need. All of this is to say, another way of describing all of this is to say that people have to enjoy their human rights in order to engage in the kinds of difficult processes that adaptation will require. So this ideally is what Palestine needs. So what does Palestine have? And I think we've seen some of this here. Palestine is a nation under occupation. It has very limited sovereignty, very limited control over its territory. There have been elections, national elections, now quite some years ago in 2007. After that, we've had municipal elections, but there has been a lack of a democratic process. We have a territory, as we have seen, which is completely fragmented in the Oslo arrangement of A, B, and C, where the Palestinian government and authority only controls a very limited part of the total territory. Most of the urban areas are controlled by Israel, Area C, which is the areas, these are the rural areas, the areas of agriculture where the water resources and other natural resources are found, and the government has no control and cannot plan for these areas. There's a complete disconnect between the urban areas and the rural areas because of this fragmentation. So the natural linkages that any society needs between urban and rural do not exist in Palestine. And Palestine obviously has no planning authority over the rural areas. In addition to that, we have the intra-Palestinian divide between Gaza and the Gaza government and the West Bank and the Ramallah government. Because of the risk of demolitions, of destruction, of investments, of confiscation of assets, obviously this is not a climate that promotes investment. It's very difficult for people to really accept to take the risk that goes with investment in this kind of environment. People live in many areas under a permanent and constant sense of insecurity and fear. And those of you who have followed the news over the past few months will understand what I'm talking about. And again, people who have experienced three wars in Gaza over the past 6 years, it's easy to understand what that leads to in terms of having absolutely no confidence and no trust in what will happen to me or my family the next day or the week after. Living under these kinds of circumstances means that you are so concerned with your immediate safety and survival for the next day, for the next week, that you get a mental state of tunnel vision. You think short term, and it's very difficult to really engage in discourse around the kind of global changes that we are discussing here today. This is the psychology of living under such stress and strain. So this is what Palestine has, and it's not exactly what I talked about in terms of what Palestine needs to deal with these consequences of climate change. But there is also, and everybody who has worked and knows Palestine has experienced and come across this paradoxical resourcefulness of Palestinians, what Palestinians like to call steadfastness or sumud, the ability to deal also with very difficult circumstances. There's a paradox. If we look around the Middle East, I would say that the most vibrant civil society, the most active human rights organizations in the whole of the Middle East are found in Palestine. Palestine has a lot to share and does already share its experiences, its knowledge in various areas with other countries in the Middle East. So we have this asset in terms of resourcefulness that is so important. So what are my conclusions against this background? One is, of course, that we cannot separate, we cannot divorce our efforts to deal with climate change from the political process leading to the emancipation of the Palestinian people. We cannot separate the end of occupation from dealing with the consequences of climate change. So the political action and action to deal with climate change have to go together. We need to engage in supporting institution building in Palestine. As we have seen, a lot has been done already. There's been a performance which is quite admirable in terms of Palestine's reporting to the climate change process and so on.
1 minute.
1 minute. And we need to also to work with civil society, those actors that have access and can engage in areas where the Palestinian Authority cannot access. We need to think about resilience in a kind of all-encompassing way. We need to think about resilience both to the consequences of the conflict, but also to the consequences and impacts between the climate change knowledge community on the one hand and the conflict knowledge community on the other hand. They seldom come together. On this panel this evening, we do come together. And I think we need to realize that the countries who are most exposed and vulnerable to climate change are the countries in conflict with the weakest institutions and where there is no full control and no ability to invest and plan for the totality of these nations' territory. So this will be my final comment, that let's think about dealing with climate change, the impacts of climate change, as something that has to be integral with building peace, not least in the Middle East and in Palestine. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Mr. Johan Schaar. Really, I would like to thank your country, the government, and people for generous support to Palestinian state and people. And we thank also your recognition of Palestinian state, which is a big recognition from you. At the same time, we don't forget also the support from Swedish government regarding the Environment Quality Authority and the climate change and capacity building and institutional developing programs inside our institution by the support. Now I will give the floor to Ms. Sarah Queen, the climate change policy advisor from Belgium country. Really, Ms. Sarah Queen has a background in international and environmental law and studied in Belgium and China. She is working as a climate change policy advisor for the Belgium Federal Environment Administration, where she previously worked on CDM projects in China and is currently focusing on governance issues and international negotiations under the UNFCCC, as well as cooperation with third countries on MRV. It's your floor, my dear.
We are very glad to contribute. And as my previous colleague pointed out, we also are convinced that climate change is a global challenge that touches every country equally, and therefore we all need to tackle it together. There is no exception for this. In my presentation, I will go a little bit more into concrete grounds and try to, via concrete cases of cooperation that we have developed, so with Palestine, try to illustrate and highlight what in our view are essential aspects of climate action, and maybe draw some conclusions on that. So for Belgium, it is important to mainstream climate change in all activities as an essential contribution to sustainable development. And that includes economic growth, socio-economic and socio-cultural development. A concrete illustration of this is a project developed by our cooperation, international cooperation, of the that's called the Eco-Sustainable School in Hebron. And to give you a concrete idea of the way it was done and how climate change was taken into account, the school was designed by taking into account, for example, the orientation of the school in the classrooms. Classrooms that were south-oriented were equipped with sunbreakers. There was the building of underground tunnels to regulate indoor temperature. And the result of that is a building that is energy saving, comfortable, and that also contributes to the avoidance of emissions of greenhouse gases. This project was also the opportunity to address the fact that climate change action requires coordination and cooperation between multiple actors involved. And concurrently, this meant, in that case, involvement of institutions at national and local level, local universities, and community-based organizations. So we hoped that the lessons learned between these actors and the sense of ownership that could be built will have a multiplier effect in the building sector in Palestine. Another project we supported that was already mentioned, that is supported by Belgium and implemented by UNDP, is the project for enhancing the capacities of the Palestinian Authority in mainstreaming environment and climate change. This project aims to develop the capacities of the Palestinian institutions in mainstreaming environment and climate change in policy framework and strategies. And in that context, the project supported the EQA for the elaboration of the Palestine National Communication and its greenhouse gas inventory. We consider this as a first milestone in the development of what we call a National Monitoring, Reporting and Review System, MRV. In our view, that MRV system is an essential tool and a prerequisite for the development of climate action. This MRV system, just to go a little bit more into concrete details, is composed of two elements: a national system for the collection and analysis of data, and a channel or a tool to report. This means the national communication in itself that aggregate all that information. And at national level, a country really needs an internal structure on which to rely for the collection and analysis of data, for policy checks and adjustments. On the other hand, the reporting of data, the report itself, enables the government and stakeholders to understand where the country stands, what are the needs, what are the areas for improvement and adjustments. And finally, such reports are also very important at international level, and that also means for international donors themselves. It enables them to have a feedback on the concrete effects of the support, but also to identify areas where they can also take action. So we therefore consider that MRV is an essential element for an effective climate action and as a step towards a low carbon and climate resilient development. We therefore hope that this project is setting a basis or premise upon which other projects could build in the future, and whereupon we can build the capacity in Palestine to tackle the impact of climate change.
Thanks a lot. I would like to introduce and to give the floor to my friend and colleague, Ms. Rima Abu Median, team leader, Natural Capital, UNDP, PABB. Rima Abu Median was born in Gaza, in Palestine. She got her PS in chemistry from the American University in Cairo in 1988, and her Master's of Public Health, specializing in environmental health management from University of Wales College of Medicine in the United Kingdom in 1994. Since then, Rima has been working and actively involved in the development of the environment sector in Palestine. In 2004, Rima joined the UNDP PAPB and is leading the environment and natural resources team. Rima enjoys her very challenging job and work at UNDP it contributes to the overall development in Palestine, in particular the environment and the climate change sectors. Welcome again, and it's your floor now.
Thank you for joining us for this very important side event. Today I would like to talk about climate change, development and opportunities, challenges in the Palestinian context, and more or less about our experience during the development of our work with our key agency, I mean the Environment Quality Authority, and the key partners actually and donors engaged in this sector. Well, first of all, I mean, UNDP globally is actually working in climate change, because climate change is one of the important strategic policies and strategic actions for globally, and we are working, I mean, on climate change because it's one of our key pillars of the global strategy. UNDP is working in many countries and with almost a portfolio of $1.3 billion, as it is one of the largest implementing agencies for climate change actions, providing assistance to government worldwide. We are also working with governments to ensure that we are supporting countries to reduce and manage risk of conflict and natural disasters, including those of climate change. Moreover, we are working also with countries to work on disaster risk management and enable countries to really be able to better prepare and respond to disasters, including those of climate change, and also with early recovery issues, especially, in Palestine. In Palestine, United Nations Development Program of Assistance to the Palestinian People, has one of its major units with the major objective to protect natural resources and environment. And we have more or less four pillars we're working on to strengthen environmental and water governance, mobilize environmental finance, improve access to water supply and sanitation, as well as solid waste management, and promoting climate change adaptation and build the Palestinian capacities on climate change mainstreaming, adaptation, and mitigation. Currently, just to give you an overview, UNDP has a portfolio of around $120 million. The environment portfolio is around $25 million. Out of the $25 million, just to give a little bit sense of our work in Palestine, we have $20 million mainly in emergency and early recovery, on rubber removal, employment opportunities through solid waste management, and only $5 million for development activities. And we have, of course, water and sanitation is a major sector in Palestine where we have a portfolio of around $60 million. I'm just giving this to show, humanitarian emergency context is really, in Palestine have the biggest portfolio and is one of our major issues. These kind of, pictures from different locations in Palestine, from Gaza and the West Bank, with solid waste issues, wastewater, the construction, as my friend Nidal mentioned, of the wall, and other issues. Yeah. And again, these are part of our work in water issues, the agricultural sector, rubber removal in Gaza, and improving access to water. And these pictures are from Gaza on our rubber removal activities. So when it comes to climate change, when we started working climate change in 2007, I remember very vividly, it was big resistance on how you come. We are a country under occupation. We have lots of challenges. We have competing priorities. We have lots of, weak infrastructure development issues. And climate change is not really one of the priorities for Palestine. And this was our major challenge to start working, with all the development agencies, with our NGOs, even with the Palestinian Authority, to talk about climate change and say, in addition to the occupation, which is our major issues and problems and major constraints for development, again, we are impacted by climate change, and it's very important that we are empowering ourselves. We are ready to really empower people, organizations, and the state to be able to adapt to climate change impacts and effects. So we started, firstly to work with the environment in 2007 and develop the climate change strategy. So the major, challenges that we faced while developing climate change programs and we're addressing climate change issues and impacts, it was, again, the Israeli occupation and the conflict context. It's really extremely difficult to, as a development agency, to work, on climate change and development while you are really also under occupation, because you have all this paradox between the emergency and the humanitarian context, versus the human, the development needs as such. So, and again, with the as we mentioned, the 8 years, we had three wars in Gaza. So again, the funds and so on, there is lots of I mean, competition between life-saving, life-sustaining, and early recovery needs, and the long-term impact. So this is another challenge that is always there. So, and the, again, the the competing priorities are really very, very, big. You know, you have the environment, climate change is a very low priority. I mean, it's for the Palestinian state as such, but also command from donors' perspectives, you know. So you'd find donors, concentrating more on a humanitarian emergency context rather than on the environment and the climate change issues. And again, with the what is going on now with the Arab Spring and all the regional problems, the competition over resources are becoming even more challenges. So there's lots of limited access, you know, and limited interest for donors to support climate change issues in Palestine. And what complicates things is that Palestine is not a signatory to the UNCCC, and we don't have any access to the environmental funds. So it's really making it very, very difficult to really address climate change issues, climate change adaptation and mitigation in mitigation measures. And again, when we started developing now the national communication report and so on, and we've done the vulnerability assessment, you have the mitigation and the adaptation challenges. As I've previously also mentioned by my colleagues, the major issue will be, even if we do the mitigation and adaptation, it will be the state of Palestine, that they don't have any control over the land resources, over water resources, where Israel controls around 85% of our water resources and around 60% of the West Bank area that constitutes, it's a big area where very limited control over that area. So this will be, again, one of the major challenges on that. Yeah. And again, the border issue is very important because, again, Palestine doesn't have control over its borders. We have the problem of blockage and siege over the Gaza Strip that also makes the developmental challenges even more and exacerbated further. However, despite this, we have lots of opportunities when you come also with climate change, or this is at least what we've witnessed, what we've experienced, that during the talk and the discussions during the climate change development of the strategy, we have lots of other agencies, state agencies, institutions are more engaged to talk about climate change. There are lots of more, awareness on this issue, so are now more engaging in that regard. Although it's a problem and it's disastrous, however, the extreme weather conditions that hit the region during the last 3 years, made people really realize the importance of climate change impacts, are more ready again to engage and to be ready to talk about it and discuss about it, because it really impacts their everyday life, improve their resilience and sustain their livelihoods. And the other thing... Okay, because of the limited, the limited access to natural resources and controls, the Palestinian people by nature are really becoming very, very resilient, and they have huge adaptive capacities. So they are ready more to engage and to do that. So we have to build upon their capacities and so on, and there's lots of potential and opportunities there. And UNDP is really very committed to work on this issue. And again, with the support from the government of Belgium and support from CEDA, we've been working, on these issues and developed the first national, Palestinian report that will be, ready in 2016. And we hope that Palestine will sign the UNFCCC and have the opportunity to access more funds and at least to be able now to engage more and to tackle the problems of climate change issues in Palestine. So this is, the strategy that we've been engaged on and developed. No, the next stage. And again, we have also some one regional projects that, again, if the peace building improves, and it's you know, there's also lots of potential for regional cooperation when it comes to climate change actions and regional climate change cooperation. So this is one of the projects that we are, working with the Israel and Jordan to downscale climate change models and to develop a joint action plan in one of the Jordan River valleys to address water resources management and issues. So that's more or less, I don't want to be lengthy, but this is the conclusions that, despite all the challenges, despite all the problems, there's lots of potential to work. UNDP is very committed to work with the state of Palestine, with the state of Palestine governments to access the funds and to be able to mitigate more or less the impacts of climate change at the different levels, but also at the community levels, and to make Palestinian people more resilient and steadfast against all these issues. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Rima, for this good presentation. It confirms the importance and seriousness of this issue, and it is the interest of our government to address the climate change and to go ahead in order to alleviate the impacts of this serious phenomena. Now, I would like to give the floor to Ms. Jacqueline McLeod, Director, Division of Early Warning and Assessment from UNEP. Professor Jacqueline is currently UNEP Chief Scientist and Director of the Division of Early Warning and Assessment. She is on leave for University College London, where she is Professor in Environmental Informatics in Earth Science. Prior to this, she was Executive Director of the European Environment Agency, Director of the Center for Coastal and Marine Science of the United Kingdom Natural Environment Research Council. Professor of Biological Science at the University of Warwick, Director of Theoretical Ecology at the FZ Jolich, and Senior Scientist at the Bedford Institute of Oceanography in the Federal Government of Canada. Well, welcome again, Ms. Jacqueline.
I would just like to start, actually, by saying that one of the things about working with Palestine is that you work together for a very long time. In other words, the last thing that anybody needs is a short project when everybody sort of walks away at the end of it. And so I was actually delighted when I met Nadal, because he's wearing a tie from the European Environment Agency, which I have to say is sort of was my home for 10 years. And I always felt that we were trying to do what we could to Palestine. So another 15-year block, and I think, I can say that I've tried to bring as many resources to the game as possible. I'm standing here actually representing my colleagues from UNEP, who are in another event down in the city. So I will be very happy to answer any questions afterwards. But let me just put this in context. We're here at a climate change conference. We've heard tremendously difficult conditions in which to undertake any kind of work on climate change. And then here comes UNEP, talking about sustainable consumption and production, the circular economy, all those kinds of things that you would imagine are way beyond anybody when they're, as very much the Swedish ambassador is saying, you're under psychological stress. But our experience, quite honestly, in working in disaster reduction and in conflict areas is sometimes normalcy is the very best thing that you can deliver. And actually it offers a lot of hope, because by doing small things that are very constructive in the daily business of life, you actually begin to create pathways for people to work through different settings. And this is really what sustainable consumption production and the project called SwitchMed is really all about. It's a long-standing process. We work with partners, of course, and in there, of course, are our European colleagues. There's a regional activity center, but it's really a lot of people trying to think what's best in the scale of what we see around the circular economy itself. And let's face it, it's in a region where having the circular economy is I won't say it's a strange animal, but it's something which is maybe not implicit in everyday life. So there's a lot to do. And yet the trade-offs and the buyouts of all the different ways in which we deal with that resources are perhaps one of the most important and critical elements, even if it's something as simple as plastics, dealing with rubble for building materials and so forth. Handling them in an environmentally good way links directly into the climate change agenda. Now, the SwitchMed is divided into three parts, three components. Very quickly, it's a policy component, and that's built around the Barcelona Convention. And again, I come back to this issue that it's important to do the normal business of government, even if you don't have all the institutions of government. So being part of the thinking of the Barcelona Convention, very important. But of course, demonstration activities, and then the networking people, showing how these functions can actually work for exchange, joint learning, giving a different kind of perspective on a daily basis. These are really the core of the SwitchMed. So reinforcing the circular economy around the Mediterranean builds a kind of liaison and a set of links. Supporting sustainable consumption policy really means that you can get national actions on the ground, and then in the end, you have sort of transfer of sound technologies, and they may be very simple technologies, but they're the basis upon which you get green entrepreneurship. And that's really the crucial point. Finally, networking, because networking itself is where we see the real opportunities. Now, to support that, what we do very well in UNEP, I think, is provide assessments. Assessments that tell you what are options, what's the scale of the problem, what are the issues that you need to address. And a sustainable consumption production assessment has all those elements, not just the policy, but the latest science, the way in which things could be scaled, things which small entrepreneurial enterprises could build up into something which in the end might even serve more than the Palestinian communities, but actually a broader part of the Mediterranean. So having a national action plan, setting out a horizon into which entrepreneurial activities can work, is very important. Building capacity, as I say, whether it's recycling materials or just thinking again about what is it you're actually going to bring into a country when its disposal might be rather difficult. So these are all elements, and I think they really do begin to make sense when you see it in the bigger picture of the 10-year framework program, which is about, in the end, consumer information, talking about how can we have lifestyles and education where this is built in. A very modest step, but nevertheless teaching children how they can look to a new future where having even the access to making new materials out of what they already have, ideas which can be, in a sense, linked all around the Mediterranean. Sustainable buildings and construction, of course, is a given, but even sustainable tourism. These are things on a horizon which maybe, if we're hopeful, are not too far away. So sharing lessons in the broader context is something which I've always discovered, particularly with many countries who are embattled, seems to give more than just simply the local rendition of what the problems are, but a way to sort of step out of that. Now, UNEP is doing a regional assessment as part of its GEO, its flagship, the Global Environmental Outlook. And it is quite striking that once the rhetoric and the discussions around the daily business of living in the conflict area are put firmly on the ground, then actually the preoccupation is about how can we live in an environmentally sustainable way. It is impacted by climate change, of course. And so one of the things we try to do is to link in through toolkits, small but nevertheless important elements, all the way up to what do we think about sand and dust storms? How can we actually prevent those taking over some parts of the territory? How can we actually make sure that people really understand the criticality of soils in relation to what's happening in climate change? So these can all be found on the SwitchMed website, the portal. And really, I hope that as we go forward, more and more of this can be seen to be feeding into a sort of small economic model which has in its own right the possibility to be representative of the circular economy and a showcase, far be it a large one, but one which can actually help people see that there are future steps to be held. I think I'll leave it at that, Chair, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Mr. Otto really, first of all, I would like to welcome you again. You visit Palestine more than one time, and you prepared a good report with your colleagues about the environment and security in Palestine. We didn't forget this document, which is very important for us. Mr. Otto Simonet, a geographer by training, is the director and co-founder of Zoo Environment Network, a non-profit organization based in Geneva, Switzerland. He has focused his career on making complex scientific and environmental issues understandable to political decision makers and a broader public. Otto Simonet holds his PhD from Zurich University in geography and has a long-standing international working experience, including extensively with the United Nations Environmental Assessment, Climate Change, Environmental Information, Management, Communication, and Capacity Building. I welcome Mr. Omet. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Excuse me, Otto. Before you start, I would like to thank you, Zoo Network, for, and especially Victor, for co-organizing this event. Without their involvement and mentorship, that was not possible to have them. And I remember, and he was working maybe for 24 hours on the mobile, waiting for my emails, and I was waiting for him email for his email. Without this involvement, very active involvement, that this side event was not possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Zoe.
Thank you, Nadal. I wanted to say the contrary. We are very, very proud and very happy to be with all of you on the same panel. It's not always, for a small non-governmental organization, it's not always granted. So thank you, and thank you for being here and listening to us. At this time on a Saturday evening, it's also not granted that the cell is still quite full. Now, like circular economy, we have also circular presentations. I think whatever I have to say has been said before. So Jackie can go through this very fast. We have published this report on environment and security in Palestine 2 years ago. It was launched in Ramallah. I want to thank Professor Mohamed Al-Hassouna. He did the main research work on this. We did the main visualization work. As a preacher type of NGO, we are very much interested that our information, first of all, is sound. It's based on science. Secondly, it reaches the people. So I think communication is one of our main issues. Among this is also visual communication. Now, this was when the report was launched. You can go through this fairly fast because it was all set. The situation, environmental situation, is very, very complex, very difficult. Climate change will make things not better. I mean, we have mentioned all the issues. Now, this is a brand new map. We wanted to show climate change impacts from